From Nashville's WSM Radio, the original home of the Grand Ole Opry, this is a Coffee, Country, and Cody podcast.
Hey, it's Charlie Maddox, and in this episode, we sit down with singer-songwriter Tim Montana. Tim had a great show at the City Winery to benefit several incredible military charities, and we would talk about that, his passion for America's military, also success writing with Kid Rock, and lots of collaborations with the legendary Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top. Enjoy our Coffee, Country, and Cody podcast with Tim Montana.
Welcome the pride of the richest hill on earth, Butte, Montana's Tim Montana. Yes, it really is his name. How do you pull that off?
They named the state after me. It's wild.
I'm born in Kalispell, am I right?
Yes, sir.
And then raised in Butte.
And recently moved to Wise River.
And where's Wise River?
38 miles south of Butte, little town of 34 people. I had to get to the mountains, man. I was cityed out.
What is the center of commerce in Wise River, Montana?
Probably the venue, 1896 Cowboy Bar Lodge that we bought. Yeah, we purchased a place up there.
See there, Charlie, your kind of place. You can drink and you can sleep.
Oh.
Well, and I love a place where you can book yourself.
Yeah.
So if you want to play a gig, I own the place.
Right? Yeah. I've showed up a few times.
Yeah, I was going to say. It's one-stop shopping, right? So, yeah. So what is the early fall like there? I can't imagine. It's just so beautiful.
When I flew to Nashville, it was 24 degrees the other morning. Uh-huh. So, yeah, it's cold. I'm yelling at my kids. They're all Nashvillians. And I'm like, hey, guys, maybe not shorts and T-shirts, but 24. We got a heck of a drive to the bus stop at 5:45 in the morning, and God, we've had 3 bear encounters already, and elk and coyotes out the window. It's pretty cool though. I was raised up there, so I just wanted my kids to get that good country raising.
Sure.
And you were raised, as I remember, in a trailer house without electricity, which actually led you to play the guitar. Give us the backstory, the audience who's maybe meeting you for the first time, Tim.
Yeah, so me and like 90-year-old people have a lot in common with this off-the-grid outhouse life. But when I was 5, we went completely off-grid in northern Montana, and then moved to the Butte area, and we were off-grid there as well. And it was a generator that would sometimes start on Sundays. And I'm glad I didn't have the distractions of television or video games like my kids have, because I had a guitar and I had a lantern, and I'd sit in that back trailer and I'd listen to the radio and pick up songs that I could hear, and that's how I developed a relationship with the guitar and music.
Did you know how kids who were living on the grid, what they were experiencing?
I had no idea.
Really?
I thought I was missing something because I go to school, you know, and but to this day, I'm still defeated by microwaves. Because I never had one. And my wife will be like, will you heat up the baby's bottle? And I'll put it in there for, 4 minutes. And I'm like, that looks good, right?
Oh.
I'm just melting. And I still have not figured out microwave. It's either cold or melted.
Wow. Oh, that's funny.
What was the one thing that when you kind of came into the electronic world that you were like, oh, yeah, that's pretty cool?
Amplifiers.
Oh, there it is. Oh.
Gearhead.
Okay. Yeah.
And then a pedal board.
Yeah. So all that stuff, like playing acoustic instruments, kind of reminds me of being poor. It's terrible, but they're like, hand me an acoustic guitar. And I'm like, oh, man, I was poor for a long time. I'm like, dude, that's a $5,000 guitar. And I'm like, I know, but it doesn't have an amp.
So I'm curious, Tim, too. You mentioned moving to get away from the city. What has the last 3 years been like with the popularity of Yellowstone? Obviously, the fictional show is not filmed there, but set in Montana.
Yeah.
The good and the bad of that.
Well, it kind of opened the floodgates for the great state of Montana, and people started moving there and actually accidentally started creating the plot line of the show.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Because now you have wealthy people moving there, running out the locals, and it's good for tourism. I don't want to knock it, but that's why I had this opportunity to buy something up there, and I bought it because I knew the owners of this historic club on the Big Hole River. And but it's just getting bought up like crazy, and it's one of the top move to states right now in the country. And, we're just all praying that January comes around and runs them out, because I don't know if they know nothing about 60 below zero.
Yeah. Right.
I can tell you a thing or two.
Yeah. You think smart people would see the irony, but they don't.
Right.
Yeah, really.
Right. And I see more celebrities up there than I see in Nashville. I'll just be in the airport in Bozeman, Montana, and I'm like, holy heck, it's Kevin Costner or it's whoever. You're just like strolling nonchalant through the airport. And I'm like, wow.
I read a quote from you. You said when you would play guitar as a youngster, you would see yourself leaving Butte and this backstory that we talked about, living off the grid. How do you wind up in Los Angeles? It's part of total culture shock, he said.
That was wild, going from a single wide trailer house, and my first stop was Hollywood, California, and I lived right on Hollywood Boulevard.
Did you really?
I remember just stopping and staring, just like sensory overload, looking at the lights and the people, and I'm like, wow. And then again, I had roommates, and the first thing they commented on was the microwave, because I never had one, never seen one, and I put a bowl in there with a spoon, and it started shooting lightning out, and I'm staring at it, and they looked at me and said, "Are you a caveman?" I said, "By God, I think I am."
One step above.
Well, yeah. Tell me about your connection to America's military, your support of them, and the next couple of nights in Nashville at the City Winery, which is one of the reasons we wanted you to stop by this morning.
Yeah, so we started the American Thread shoot, and this goes back years ago. When I was 17, I had recruiters hanging at my house. You know, I thought I'd be a good candidate because I grew up off the grid, and I was always stacking wood and running in the snow and hunting and fishing and this and that. So these recruiters caught on to that, and they're like, let's get this country kid. So my mom would get so mad because I was trying to sign the early release stuff, and she wouldn't sign it. She's like, oh, no. And she was like, what about music school? She was trying everything she could to persuade me. And I remember the day I got accepted to Musicians Institute in Los Angeles, she was like, praise Jesus. So, but I think part of that hung with me as a little guilt that I didn't serve. And when I met Chris Kyle, the American Sniper, I did a guitar for them with Gibson. It ended up raising, I think, over 100,000. And he said, man, if you didn't serve, it's our duty to serve those that served us. And that really hit home to me. And when I got to give him that check, he's like, you impacted some lives with this check. And so I was like, I want to do this again. Mm-hmm. And so then we did a guitar the next year at Gibson, and that raised around $35,000. And then someone said, start an event. And I'm like, well, I don't golf. I'm terrible at golf, and it's not my thing. I can drive the heck out of a golf cart at high speeds. But so I said, let's do a shotgun shoot, a sporting clay shoot. And so we started it. And no idea what we're doing. Me, my buddy Trevor Pardue, and Scott Graves with Special Ops Excursions, where we take active duty operators. When they get off deployment, we take them in the woods. We let them disconnect. It's therapeutic for them. They get to hunt and fish, and you know, they're not getting shot at. So it's really good for these soldiers to come home and have someone love on them and feed them and play them music. And so we said, let's start this event. And officially, we found out today with the money we raised in 4 years, this will be over $1 million we've raised for this program. And we always pick a second beneficiary as well. So we had children of fallen patriots, kids that lost their parents or parents in combat. And we were on Fox last year, and someone called and donated $200,000, a check, which we got 8 scholarships for kids to go to college. So this is the year we break $1 million. And I couldn't be happier, man, because you know, it's just cool to be able to affect lives like that and change lives, and it makes me feel good, makes the community feel good, and this concert tomorrow night, sold out, and some of the rock stars and country stars we have coming to the winery tonight, the concert's tonight, actually, is pretty wild, so.
So who's coming?
Oh, gosh.
Who's coming?
Michael Ray is coming.
Okay.
My right-hand man. I'm going to go ahead and leak it. Collective Soul is coming up from Atlanta. Maybe the bubbly girl, Kobe Calais. All right, I've said too much. Daryl Worley. Shelby Shane.
And, you know, Tennessee has been at the forefront of high school shooting teams. In as extracurricular activity like other sports.
Yeah.
And that has been a very huge and groundbreaking move on behalf of Tennessee education extracurricular activities.
Yeah. Yeah. I think firearms education is very important. Mm-hmm. The school my kids go to, they came to me and said, Mr. Montana, we're doing a field trip with your boys. My boys go to a schoolhouse of 6 students. K through 8, and they are 2 of them. So there's 4 other kids.
So if they're out, 33% of the school population is gone.
Yes, we've increased the population substantially in Wise River, Montana, but he said, we're doing a field trip, and we're going to shoot flintlocks.
Oh, right.
Like, and he's an Army vet, and he's like, are you okay with it? I'm like, 100% can dad go.
Yeah, that's the one that goes,
boom. Yeah, so I'm excited.
Got to burn from the powder over, see, and then... Here we go.
Yeah.
Game
on.
Fire in a hole. All right, Tim, we're going to play Devil You Know, which you were sharing some success that you learned about where it is on the charts.
Probably. Yeah, it debuted in the top 40, which was I didn't know this was happening. It's the same day I moved to Montana and closed on that property. It was the same day the single went out. and getting to see my name in Billboard magazine, and then today it landed at 20 on the charts, so it's officially my first top 20 active rock hit. So
congratulations.
Thank you.
We're going to share it with the world right now, all over the world, on WSM Radio, WSMRadio.com, and Circle Television, CircleAllAccess.com, and, of course, the mobile app with our programming on demand up to 24 hours. That's Circle Now, available in your app store.
It's a devil you know and a devil you don't. One's in your head and one's in your soul. All my life's been the same damn thing. Still chasing something I can't see. It's a devil you know.
Devil you know, a little earlier. You got to see it and hear it all over the world from Tim Montana, our special guest. City Winery Nashville presenting the fourth annual Tim Montana and Friends American Thread, that benefit concert tonight at 8 o'clock. And then the shoot is tomorrow, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What time's the shoot?
Guests get there about 11 a.m., but we'll be on Fox and Friends all morning from 4:40 a.m. is my first hit time live.
If somebody would like to interview Michael Ray, he is on location now.
Yeah, apparently. He's there. And he got there a day early. Yeah, to check it out.
Please stop and talk to him. Ask him a few questions. Just passersby in general.
Well, he saw the guy mowing. Maybe he's helping with that. Right?
So. Michael's mowing the lot for us. That is devotion, my friend.
You know how to run a zero turn?
Woo.
Hop on, horse.
There's a chance of whiskey and rain today, boys.
Yeah. Well, you know, there are two names that pop up a lot when you're talking about Tim Montana. One is Billy Gibbons, and I know Bill is the ZZ Top guy. The other is Kid Rock, because you've had great success with both.
Yeah.
And I only know Kid Rock as the performer. I know what I would think to be the caricature of Kid Rock. Mm. What's Bobby like?
He's great, man. Yeah. I got to co-write two of his singles, Tennessee Mountaintop and Greatest Show on Earth, and I think they both were top 40. So he kind of brought me into his world, and a military vet introduced me to him, a Navy SEAL from Butte, Montana, Rob O'Neill, the guy that fired the shots that killed Bin Laden, actually connected me with him. And so we just hit it off, and I started touring with him and going on his Kid Rock cruise, which is wild. and we just cultivated this friendship, and he's a good dude.
Well, recently, you and I, the last time we saw each other was at the America Salutes You, Billy Gibbons, the special television taping special at the Grand Ole Opry House that I hosted. And you were one of the guests on the lineup that night, paying homage to the Reverend. And your friendship began when you met in a studio. Was that the backstory?
Yeah, I just texted him the other day on September 13th. I said, happy 10-year. It's our anniversary. A decade of friendship. Aww. A decade of whiskers. But he took me under his wing, man, at a time when no one gave, you know, it didn't care about me. And you know, there were times where people pushed him to bring someone else on tour. And he said, no, I'm bringing this guy on tour. And he's just been in my corner fighting and just teaching me so much about this industry, and just never gave up on me.
What was the first introduction like, though? The first meeting for you?
Yeah, I had a song called This Beard Came Here to Party. I had a chorus written, and somebody got it to him, and he showed up in the studio. I'll never forget, he walked in with his little red SG, and we sat down and wrote it, and I was just like baffled, and I was like, hey, man, if this is the one and only time I get to meet my hero, I'm a lucky man. And fate had different plans, because that night he went to a dinner. Somebody came up to get a selfie with him, and Billy said, what are you doing? He goes, I pair songs with sports teams, and the Boston Red Sox are growing beards out, and we need a beard song. And I'm not even kidding. Billy had a mixtape in his pocket or a CD, and he pulled it out and gave it to the guy. And 72 hours later, I watched my first sporting event, because I grew up without TV. I didn't watch sports, and I hear my song playing at Fenway Park. And then they won the World Series. And next thing I know, me and Billy are on the cover of USA Today with the Boston Red Sox. And it said, the beard came here to win.
And you sang the anthem shortly after
that,
right?
Yeah, I got to sing the anthem at Fenway Park. I got to paint home plate. And then Billy, shortly after that, is picking my kids up at school and said, hey, what are you doing Thursday? And I said, I don't know. And he goes, why don't you open for ZZ Top at the Ryman? And I was bawling my eyes out. My kids are like, Dad, are you okay? I'm like, I'm playing the Ryman with ZZ Top. He snuck me into the coolest places on earth.
Tim Montana and the Shrednecks, huh?
Yeah.
Back in the day. Well, I was also, he's also a business partner, I understand, at the Wise River Club, 1896 in Montana, that we referenced earlier, where one day ago on Instagram, come see us tonight for Montana Raised Ribeyes and Nashville Hot Chicken.
Oh. You slid it in there.
Oh, man, I'm taking everything I learned from Music City and plugging it in the woods. But, yeah, we took over.
And if people want to follow up, by the way, it's wiseriverclub.net.
Yeah, we're actually doing wiseriverclub.com. The website's going to launch here soon. But you can follow us on Facebook and Instagram at Wise River Club. But this place opened in 1896. It's just a historical spot in the Big Hole Valley. And Gibbons put together a little group of guys. Gibbons is in there. And so I volunteered to go run it in this small little country town. And I'm loving it, man. We got a little songwriter stage and big things coming at the Wise River Club. And Billy and I have a hot sauce company together, Whisker Bomb. So we make barbecue sauce, salsa, hot sauce. That's at HEB in Texas. That's at Harris Teeter. That's at Murdoch's Farm and Ranch Store. Now we're plugging it in at the world-famous Wise River Club. 1896, by God.
That's amazing. Well, and as many people as you know that are here that love to be out there, I mean, you're going to get some draws. People are going to come out there. They want to play, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, if you want me for a show, you're going to have to ask nicely because I really like it out there.
That's it.
Hey, man, thanks for coming to see us. We're going to close with, what did we decide? American Threat?
Yeah, just to kind of bring it all home since that's
America,
the theme of the benefit.
I thought I wanted to double check. Mm-hmm. But Tim Montana and friends, it's the fourth year for his American Thread benefit concert tonight at 8 o'clock, and the competition shoot is tomorrow. Raising funds and awareness the best possible way with a night of music, food, and freedom. And two exceptional military 501c3 benefits, nonprofit benefits. Tim, thank you so much for getting up early.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Was the coffee to your liking? Was it?
It's so good.
Good Montana camp coffee.
I didn't give him the pumpkin spice.
You didn't?
No, I didn't think.
Oh, I wish I would have loved to have seen the reaction.
Just smiles. My beard falls out.
Wait a minute. Before you go, tell Tim what you gave Charlie Daniels on your first show almost 30 years ago at WSM.
Charlie Daniels was my first guest. We'd been friends for a year. So when I
one of my heroes
got the opportunity to come to WSM to do mornings in the Opry, they said, who you want as your first guest? I said, Charlie Daniels. So they worked it out. Got it scheduled, got him in here. And at that time, we had a coffee shop down the hallway here at the hotel that catered coffee and donuts and rolls and that sort of thing for breakfast. And that particular morning selection was chocolate raspberry truffle.
Wow.
So he took one sip. He didn't see us making it. And you just took one sip, like your cup sitting there in front of you. And he said, Cody, ever since you left Texas, you started drinking hippie coffee.
That's pretty good.
I was shamed, and I should have been. Yeah. Thank you again, Tim.
Thank you.
You're on WSM Radio, Circle TV.
Tough as nails, hard as bricks, 6'1", walking 10'6", 4 on the floor, 12 in the back, with a weather god box in an old gun rack. Feeling fly, riding high, roughneck red till the day we...
Thanks for listening to the Coffee, Country, and Cody podcast. Make sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. And please leave us a 5-star review. This podcast was produced through the facilities of WSM Radio in Nashville, Tennessee. The hosts of Coffee, Country, and Cody are Bill Cody, Charlie Mattos, and Kelly Sutton. Producer, Eric Markham. WSM General Manager and Director of Content and Programming, J. Patrick Tittle. Copyright 2023. Opry Entertainment Group Holdings, LLC.